In this video, we will combine our basic knowledge of quantum mechanics and special relativity to take a look at nuclear physics. Having covered the atomic structure and looked at the hydrogen atom in detail, the next step would be to consider large atoms and nuclear physics. In this video, we will take a look at fusion and fission, two different nuclear processes. Fusion is what powers the sun, and we will see how quantum tunneling also comes into play in explaining the fuel cycle of the stars. We look at how simple binding energy calculation can show us the power of the atom and look at the basic principles of how nuclear power works. One of the core concepts to nuclear physics is what we call binding energy. This is related to Einstein's famous equation E equals to mc squared. The thing is that atoms are composed of electrons, protons and neutrons. The important thing is that if you measure the mass of an atom and then compare it to the mass of its constituent particles, then the mass of the atom will be lighter than the constituents. This is because mass and energy are related, and some of the mass of the constituent particles turns into the binding energy that holds the atoms together. The calculation is so simple that all you need is basic math, a periodic table, and the mass of the proton and neutron. The mass of the electron is so small that it can be ignored, but just to keep things intuitively, let's calculate with it now. If we take the mass of the helium-4 atom and subtract its constituent particles, we find that helium-4 minus 2 protons, 2 neutrons and 2 electrons is equal to minus 28.3 mega electron volt, where P is protons, N is neutrons and E is electrons. We thus see that there is around 28 mega electron volt binding energy in regular helium-4. If you did this calculation for the different elements of the periodic table and divided the result with the number of protons and neutrons in the element, you get the average binding energy per nucleon. This graph goes up in the beginning, and then after element iron 56, it starts going down again. As we will see later, this is important for the nuclear properties of the element. There is in general two nuclear processes which we consider. One is called fusion and the other is called fission. In some ways, these processes are the opposite to each other. Fusion is when two atoms combine to form a larger atom, and fission is when a larger atom splits into smaller atoms. As usual, the important thing is energy. Remember, the highest binding energy per nucleon is for iron 56. This, as a rule of thumb, means that the atoms lighter prefer fusion and atoms heavier than iron prefers fission. In this way, we end up with a process that releases energy, which is what we want, as we want to minimize the energy of the system. Let's consider a simple fusion process of two different helium atoms, helium-3 with one neutron and helium-4 with two neutrons as before. If all the protons and neutrons fuse into a new atom, we get beryllium-7. If we again consider the mass of beryllium and subtract the mass of the two helium atoms, we get beryllium-7 minus the mass of helium-3 plus the helium-4 atom, then the result is minus 1.59 megaelectrovolt. As expected, we reduce the energy of the system as highlighted by the minus sign. This energy will leave the system, and this is how fusion works. Given the right conditions, the atoms start fusing together up until they form iron. After that, the process is no longer feasible and the fusion chain stops. This is essentially how stars work. Before moving on to fission, let's consider the star and fusion in more detail. If we look at the atom, it has a positively charged nucleus, so if you put two nucleons together, you have a problem. The two nucleons will repel each other. Technically, the electrons have a similar problem, but they can move to other shells and make themselves fit into the new atom. It turns out that this repulsion leads to a Coulomb barrier, similar to the double well potential, which we discussed in the video about tunneling. Because this barrier is so big, It is almost impossible for the neutrons in the stars to overcome this repulsion. What saves this process is quantum tunneling, which allows the nucleons to tunnel through the barrier and fuse together. This fusion process in stars can thus create the different elements of the periodic table up until iron. Our sun, however, is not big or hot enough to make iron, and it will probably only produce up to oxygen. As mentioned earlier, fission is like the opposite of fusion. It is the process of splitting an atom. Some atoms are better in doing this than others, and recalling from earlier, the binding energy also plays a role. Some atoms are considered fissile material, like uranium-235. If you hit one of these atoms with a neutron, it can split into two and undergo a fission reaction. In general, the atom will split into two atoms of different sizes, rather than two of the same size. An example of the process is uranium-235. If we hit it with a neutron, it will turn into uranium-236, which is very unstable, and it could, for example, split into barium-144, krypton-89, and 3 neutrons. This process then sends out more neutrons that can split up more atoms, and thus you have a chain reaction. This is how nuclear energy is produced. The mass of the initial atoms is lighter than the resulting atoms and neutrons, thus you have some of the mass of the fissile material that turns into energy, just like in fusion. In this example, 177 mega electron volt of energy is produced. The energy released is, however, less compared to fusion if you consider the fact that atoms in fission process are much larger, as fusion is generally an even more powerful process per nucleon compared to fission. While fusion in theory gives you more energy and it's what powers the sun, it is much harder to replicate on Earth because you need so much energy to overcome this Coulomb barrier. To make fusion on Earth, you basically have to make a small sun and then somehow extract the energy from that. Nuclear fission is much easier for energy production on Earth, you just need to maintain a nuclear chain reaction in a reactor core. The energy from fission produces heat. This heat can then heat up water, just like an old school coal power plant. The water then boils and turns into steam. This steam then drives a turbine, which drives a generator that gives us energy, or electricity. One can also use the excess heat from the coolant water to produce hot water for homes. The big advantage of nuclear power is that the fission material is extremely energy dense compared to any other energy source. Thus, with a few kilograms of uranium, you can power your house for a year. In comparison, you would need more than a ton of coal to produce the same amount of energy, and nuclear power doesn't emit any greenhouse gases. Nuclear physics has almost existed for 100 years. The quantum mechanics involved in nuclear process is very complicated, and it is computed using simulations on powerful computers, which is why we have not got into the details of the math. But as we see, tunneling is very important, and just by using Einstein's famous energy equivalence principle, we can get an intuitive feel for the power of the atom. Nuclear physics has given us the power of the atom, and with that a new method of producing clean energy, but we must be careful to apply it safely. I hope you found this video interesting and learned something new. As always, please like, comment and subscribe for more videos. Stay tuned for more.